we're back. 'Cause a lot of Osteen updates lately.
Sad as I can be, all by myself, an uncharted island in an endless sea. What makes me happy fills me up with glee. Those bones in my jaw don't have a flaw, my shiny teeth and me. My shiny teeth that twinkle just like the stars in space. My shiny teeth that sparkle, adding beauty to my face.
And my falsetto is a little off.
Just like a Christmas tree. You love to walk the mile just to see me smile. Woo! Shiny teeth and me. Yes, they're all so perfect. So white and pearly. Brush, gargle, rinse, a couple breath mints. My shiny teeth and me. My shiny teeth so awesome. Just like a favorite song. My shiny teeth that blossom. So they grow to be real strong. Shiny teeth, I love them, and they all love me. What should I talk to you when I got 32? Woo! Shiny teeth and me.
All right, yeah, that's our Joel Osteen update music. Man, he's been in the news a lot lately. Anyway, the folks over there at the Christian Post scored an interview with Joel Osteen, where he was asked a question. You know, with the new, was it Ross Douthwaite? He's written a book about, you know, American heretics. And kind of takes on the Joel Osteen prosperity gospel type of thing. So the gal conducting the interview there at the Christian Post asked him about it, and his answer was, well, interesting. Here's Joel Osteen.
You know, I don't consider myself, I don't really know what the prosperity gospel is. The way I
He doesn't know what the prosperity gospel is. Really? You also don't know what Mormonism teaches either. Weird.
Define it is, I believe God wants you to prosper in your health, in your family, in your relationships, in your business, in your career. So I do, if that's the prosperity gospel, I do believe that. I don't.
Yeah, that sounds a lot like the prosperity gospel. And it's a heresy.
I don't believe we're supposed to go through life defeated.
Yeah, I don't believe. Yeah, weird. Why aren't you saying things like, God's word clearly reveals that da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Really, we're not supposed to go through life defeated. Can you preach this gospel, if it is, even is a gospel? Could you preach it to somebody, you know, to the martyrs of the Christian faith, you know, both in antiquity and in present times? In fact, I've read reports that persecution that Christians are suffering around the world is at an all-time high. Never before in the history of the world has Christianity suffered so much, you know, in organized persecution, especially the hands of Islam. You know, so you know, do you think that those guys are just not getting it? Do you think the folks that are living in those, you know, nations where Muslims are in control and they can't even worship publicly, and they, you know, could face death as a result of their proclamation of Christ and crucified. Do you think the problem is that they're just not embracing, you know, with their words, the prosperity, you know, that God wants us to be victors, not victims, that kind of thing? Do you think that's a problem? They just don't have enough faith?
And not having enough money to pay our bills or send our kids to college, so... You know, when I hear some of that, I think that's not who I am. He doesn't know me or what I teach.
Yeah, but I do. And yeah, you're saying it just right here, yeah.
Because, you know, he's saying God doesn't, you know, believe that, you know, there's no demand. Or I don't think I'd put it like that. But I talk about God rewards obedience.
Yeah. Wow. That's all law. You really think you're obedient?
When you follow his ways, the Bible says that his blessings will chase you down and overtake you. And my life.
So that's it. See, the reason why Joel Osteen is so prosperous and so successful, I mean, is because he's so obedient. Mm. And see, the reason why you're so poor and why you're struggling to pay your bills is because, well, you're not obedient like Joel is.
Life is an example of that. I've seen God's goodness, and so...
That's what he even said. My life is an example of that. Got to back this up so you can hear it in context. I mean, this is just... Wow.
But always talks about, I talk about God rewards obedience. When you follow his ways, the Bible says that his blessings will chase you down and overtake you. And my life is an example of that. I've seen God's goodness. And so,
yeah, because you're so obedient.
I don't consider it the prosperity gospel. I don't think he has me characterized right. You know, sometimes people take a clip here, a clip there. But if, you know, I talk many times about trials, suffering, you know, being your best when your prayers aren't being answered. So,
okay, so there you go. Joel Osteen. So, oh, wow. And by way of kind of countering this, the Reverend Brian Lee of Christ Reformed Church in Washington, D.C. wrote a recent piece entitled Osteen Says God Wants to Supersize Your Joy. So what's wrong with that? I'll let Dr. Brian Lee have the Reverend Dr. Brian Lee have the last word here. He writes, and this is on the White Horse Inn blog, on Sunday night, April 29th, 2012, 41,000 fans packed National Stadium in Washington, D.C. to hear a message of hope, inspiration, and encouragement from Joel Osteen. Most paid about $20, including fees for the privileges. Osteen sold out the stadium, a feat that the Nationals rarely accomplish. But did he have to sell out to do so? Osteen is the latest embodiment of the American religion revivalism. For centuries now, preachers have known how to fill stadiums or circus tents, or turn their churches into a circus, and send people home with hope in their heart and a skip in their step. Osteen promises you will leave a transformed person, at least until his tour comes around again next year, when you can be transformed again. Osteen's message is a positive one for a difficult time. Every one of us has seeds of greatness inside, potential that has not yet been released, buried treasure waiting to be discovered. If you were a car, you would be fully loaded and totally equipped with pinstripes, he says, gesturing to his suit. Before God created you, he planned great things for you. As you stretch your faith, God is going to show up and show out in tremendous ways. If you don't step into your destiny and release your gift, then this world will not be as bright as it should be. That's a pretty positive message. What could be wrong with that? Well, the biggest problem with Osteen's message about God is that it really is a message about me. God is a potential, a force, a co-pilot, waiting to be tapped and deployed. I may have a net below me, but I am the one that has to take the first steps on the wire. Taking steps of faith is imperative to fulfilling your destiny. When I make a move, God will make a move. When I stretch my faith, God will release more of his favor. When I think bigger, God will act bigger. God is as big as I think him to be. Yes, this is the American religion. A program, a plan, 5 simple steps to help me be all that I can be. This is the religion of the bootstraps, where God helps those who help themselves. By the way, an overwhelming majority of Americans believe that is a quote from the Bible, but it's not. And that's the second problem. Osteen's message is not biblical. His promise that his audience will be taught the Bible from a preacher who has admitted that teaching the Bible isn't his strength is fulfilled with a smattering of verses. These snippets are at best torn out of their context and at worst fabricated. There's this stretch, quote, God is saying to you what he said to Lot. Hurry up and get there so I can show you my favor in a greater way, end quote. In Genesis 19:22, the angel does tell Lot, get there quickly, for I can do nothing until you arrive there. God waiting on Lot to step out in faith so that he can bless him? Not exactly. It is God telling Lot to flee to Zoar, a city of safety, so that he can rain down fire on Sodom and Gomorrah. Osteen bolsters his bootstrap religion by quoting Jesus, quote, roll away the stone and I'll raise Lazarus, end quote. This, Osteen says, is a principle, quote, God expects us to do what we can, and he will do what we can't. If you will do the natural, God will do the supernatural, end quote. Well, one problem. Jesus does command them to roll away the stone. But no such quid pro quo is found in Holy Writ. This foundational principle is one of Osteen's own making. it is not primarily the details of Osteen's biblical sunbeams that are problematic. It's the overall message. What's missing is any sense of human sin. Osteen leads his crowd in a mantra at the opening of his performance where he says, "This is my Bible. Tonight I will be taught the word of God. I can do what it says I can do." Again, bootstraps. What does the Bible say that we can do for ourselves? Our best works, according to the Bible, are like filthy rags, the prophet Isaiah teaches, Isaiah 64:6. We are all like sheep that have gone astray, Isaiah 53:6. Paul says all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23, and includes himself in all of this as the chief of sinners, 1 Timothy 1:15. The big problem is that we don't want what's good for us, and when we do, Paul says, "The good that I want to do, I do not do," Romans 7:19. Ring true? Well, it does for me. That's why the stadium will be full next year. Self-esteem doesn't help me. It just leaves me with more me digging deeper within. So how about Jesus? Surely he's more upbeat than Paul or the prophets. Well, he does offer this simple recipe to happiness. Quote, "Sell all you possess, give it away to the poor, and then follow me." You've done that yet? Well, yes, he does say that our faith makes us well, but he is the healer our faith looks to. He also tells the paralytic to take up his bed and walk, but only after he's healed him. So what we want is the excitement and the encouragement and the affirmation of the stadium. God is waiting for you to act. What we need is the truth and compassion of Jesus. "Come to me, you who are weary, and I will give you rest." After the adrenaline boost, I hope some of those 41,000 people find their way through the desert to some place where they can get a drink of water. Earlier Sunday, 45 worshipers, about 0.1% of Osteen's crowd, gathered at Christ Reformed Church in Logan Circle and other churches in the city to hear a message of sin and salvation. The good news of a God who loves those who are his sworn enemies. They responded to God's word with prayer, song, and confession, and they received the benediction of a God who pardons sin full and free. There was hope and inspiration too, but of an entirely different sort, and admittance was free. Yeah, I think that op-ed piece clearly demonstrates the difference between the wide highway that leads to hell and the narrow path that leads to eternal life. The biblical message, the message that Christians have been called to proclaim, is radically different than the message that Joel Osteen preaches. He might fill stadiums. Problem is that the people in that stadium eventually will find themselves in hell if they believe the message that they're being taught. Moving along.